Greetings, Mathophiles, and welcome to a video on an incredibly useful study technique in math and in a number of other domains as well called retrieval practice. Retrieval practice is a method of preparation that is very effective in helping you to onboard and then later recall facts, formulas, dates, theorems, things of this kind that may be from time to time necessary to commit to memory. Retrieval practice is about what's called the testing effect or the retrieval practice effect, the idea behind which is sounds quite simple. The way to improve your ability to recall something is to practice recalling that something. I first learned about this in a book called Make It Stick, The Science of Successful Learning by a writer named Peter C. Brown and two psychology professors at Washington University in St. Louis, Henry L. Roediger III and Mark A. McDaniel. This was a book that changed my practice as a teacher. And I encourage you to read it. There's, to some extent, this video is a bit of a book report on this book, although I can tell you that the results have continued to hold up. I virtually attended a conference about a month ago in which Barbara Oakley, who actually also wrote a wonderful book called A Mind for Numbers, How to Excel at Math and Science, indicated that the research since this book came out continues to support these ideas as one of the more robust results in all of learning. People make a lot of claims about what research shows about how students learn and how best to teach this or that topic. I can tell you that this is one of the most well-supported notions in that entire realm. So I'll give you one example. There's a lot of laboratory evidence. There's a growing body of evidence that comes from actual work with students in schools. And here's one such example. This was in a school called Columbia Middle School in Columbia, Illinois. It involved sixth grade social studies over three semesters starting in 2006. And students were administered quizzes on material that they had been taught. The quizzes were created by a research assistant so that the teacher would not know what material had been quizzed and what material had not been quizzed. And then at the ends of units, students were tested on the material, as one does. And the students who had been, the students scored a full grade higher on the material that had been quizzed by the researchers than on the material that had not been quizzed, which is, you know, a very impressive result, right? I mean, we go to, as students, we go to lots of effort to raise our performance by even fractions of that amount. So it's a pretty impressive thing. This was repeated at the same school in science classes the next year. 79% average on unquizzed material, 92% average on quiz material. So from a C plus to an A minus. Pretty powerful effect. Flashcards are a great way to do this for fact-based information, formulas, theorems, definitions, and so on. And you can even extend this beyond math to dates in a history class or irregular verbs in a modern language class, terminology in a science class. It's very powerful, and it's useful across all kinds of domains. It shouldn't be necessary for me to explain how flashcards work. I think we all, whether or not we use them, know what they're about. But there is one important tip with which you might not be familiar, and I want to dwell on that a little bit. There seems to be something important about pausing and fully completing the act of recalling the content before you turn the card over. So if I'm looking at a flashcard that has to do with the derivative of some function in calculus, I don't want to flip it right over immediately. I want to sort of pause for a moment, fully complete the act of recalling the formula, and then turn it over and either verify that it was right or see that I was wrong and kind of make a mental note to correct myself the next time. So don't whiz through these things too quickly. Some other advice, all of it well supported by experiment. Your practice should be spaced rather than massed, meaning you're much better off doing small amounts of retrieval practice every day or every other day than you are doing it for a much longer period of time, say the night before a test. So masked practice is sort of retrieval practice speak for cramming. And it's not a good thing in the long run. It can help you to do well on a test on a Thursday, but that material is not necessarily going to be available to you going forward. And speaking as a teacher of calculus, where you sort of have to bring it all forward with you, cramming is not a good practice. Second thing your practice should be is randomized. You don't want the cards to be in the same order all the time, because to some extent, you're memorizing not only the content, but you're memorizing the content in specific set of relationships, one fact to another. And that's not what you want either, because the demands that are placed on you to recall are not in a fixed order either. So you want to shuffle the cards, basically. It's good for practice to be what's called interleaved. I mentioned dates and history and irregular verbs and so on. And you can actually take flashcards that you may have for different courses and shuffle them up. There's something about the randomness. There's something about the demand to recall this thing from over here and then this thing from over here and so on that makes the effect on your memory even that much more robust. Recall also should be effortful. You don't want to fall into what's called the illusion of mastery or the familiarity trap. And this is a little bit about what I said a moment ago about pausing. You don't want to make it so easy on yourself that your brain isn't doing that little bit of effort that it takes to recall the fact on its own. And finally, speaking as a math person, when you're dealing with formulas or theorems, you want to be attentive not only to results, but to conditions. And I'll put up here a flashcard for the mean value theorem from calculus. And it's important not only to know the result, but it's important to know the conditions under which the result obtains, because you can't be confident outside of those conditions that the thing is going to play out the way it's supposed to. Bit of a word about rereading. This is a common thing that people do when they're studying. You reread a section of a textbook, or you reread segments of your notes. And if you've been away from material for a while and you need to refresh yourself on what it was about, that's an excellent technique. I'm not saying never do it, but I'm saying that it's not a good way of making sure that you have fluid, accurate recall of the facts and relationships and other things that you may want to have at your disposal in terms of information from your courses. Rereading tends to be time-consuming. It tends to be not nearly as effective as really intentional retrieval practice. And again, it can make you subject to the illusion of mastery, because you read the content and you say, yeah, sure, I know that. And you end up confusing familiarity with actual knowledge and ability to call upon these things when you need them. Some other helpful strategies. If you're preparing for a math test, working problems. Makes total sense, right? What does a math test ask you to do? Work problems. So what should you do in preparing for a math test? Work problems. But work them with as little support as possible. Obviously, you're going to have your book nearby in case you get stuck on something. Obviously, you're going to want to check your results if you have some answers available. But what you don't want to do is rely too much on aids that you're not going to have at your disposal when you're taking the test. Because again, you can sort of mislead yourself into thinking you're better prepared than you are. There's a technique called elaboration, re-expressing in your own words, content, theorems, relationships, whatever the material may be, is a very powerful technique, because it forces a bit of processing that helps the information to stick in your memory. Reflection. Pondering connections, asking yourself sort of what-if questions, asking yourself what the consequences of a particular idea might be, asking yourself follow-up questions, very useful, because again, it sort of forces the brain to engage a little more deeply in processing. Mnemonics are helpful, I don't need to tell you this. Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally, or Holmes for the Great Lakes. There are all kinds of good sort of chunking and memory aid tricks out there for various bits of content, and they're useful and you should use them. And finally, there's a thing called a brain dump, where you just sit down and you write out everything that you can remember from what you learned that day, or everything that you remember from a body of material that you're going to be tested on. That's a type of retrieval practice as well, and it can be very useful. So it should be clear from all that I've said that I'm a big fan of this. My students, since I began to emphasize this, have told me that they found it to be very helpful. So I have a fair amount of personal anecdote as well, in addition to, as we said, the pretty large and growing body of scientific support. So give this a try. I think you're going to find that it is of benefit to you. Happy mathing.